Hey guys, hey everyone. Welcome to the seventh week of the Ask Our Vet series, live from the Earth Animal Studios. I figured we'd come in with a little Stevie Wonder, because who couldn't ever use any Stevie Wonder, right? Kind of a wet, dreary day today in Southport. We had some great weather this week, though, which was nice to get out and still social distance, right? But get out and, hey, Greg, thanks for joining in. It was nice to get out this week. We had some nice weather up here and get out and do a little hiking. And again, still social distance, but just get some sun and it feels good. Today is a little dreary. So I thought the Stevie intro will pick us up a little bit and just improve the mood, right? So as I said, week seven, Ask Our Vet series. Welcome everybody. Today we're gonna do a quick recap of COVID. We've been doing that weekly. And you know, the good news is that this week there's not anything new to report. You know, we've had the sequence of events over the past 3 weeks where we had the tiger positive a few weeks ago, and then we had the two cats in upstate New York. And subsequently last week, we talked about Winston the pug down in North Carolina. The good news with all those animals was that they all had mild symptoms. Winston, who came up positive last week in a household where people had the SARS-CoV-2, which is obviously the virus that causes COVID, that dog had very mild symptoms and they did not, and had very low levels of the virus. And they do, again, with any of these animals, they did not suppose that they posed a risk back to humans at this point. And that still stands. You know, we obviously, this is unfolding weekly. The good news again is that we have all the animals they've tested, we've had just very few crop up with it and also have mild disease. So that's all good news. I think, you know, what we've talked about and built upon over the last several weeks still stands, right? It's changed from the, you know, the original, again, 4 or 5 weeks ago, where if you suspect you have COVID or you know you do and you're obviously quarantined and sheltering in place, not only are you then going to be quarantining from your family members and your friends, but you also need to quarantine from your pets, just in an abundance of caution, okay? So I think that, and again, if it's not possible, if you live alone and you still have to take care of your pet, then what you're going to be doing is you're going to be taking all the necessary precautions. You want to wear a mask when you're with your pet, gloves if possible. If not, wash your hands really well before and after you're near them and you feed them and things like that. So we're just, again, taking abundance of caution. We've had very few animals crop up with this to this point, and really with very mild disease. So each week, I'll just keep filling you in on the latest. And but again, good news this week, nothing really new on that front. I think on the human front, as we're seeing, what we've been doing is helping. Numbers are going down. They're starting to talk about phase one in many states, and already started in some states where they're opening things. Up here, they have the date of May 20th or May 19th to start doing some things. And I think while we want to get back to normalcy, I think we all have to, again, as I keep saying, with an abundance of caution, when you're back out, I think we have to, I know we're all, you know, chomping at the bit to get outside and get back with friends we haven't seen and get back. But I think the important thing to do is follow directions and do this slowly in phases, because I think ultimately we don't want to get back in a situation where the numbers really spike and we're all going to be back in the sheltering in place. Okay, so anyway, there's the COVID update. We're going to be also talking about flea and tick control today. And the basis is we're going to talk about conventional. You know, one of the things I always tell people is, you know, I'm an open book. I'm a conventionally trained traditional veterinarian who always believed in both adjunct medicine with natural and traditional therapies. It's one of the ways that I've gotten to know Dr. Goldstein, because I've been working with him on adjunct medicine for years now, and that has I've learned a tremendous amount from him. He's, you know, whenever I get a chance, I love to sit and talk to him. He's just an absolute wealth of knowledge. He and his wife Susan. So we. I've been lucky to be able to work with them for my clients and my patients over the years. And that's kind of then morphed into me coming on to Earth Animal, and I learned something every day. I literally learned something every day. So the way we're going to approach it is we're going to talk about, you know, kind of the conventional flea and tick control. And then we're going to get into the natural. We're going to get into the Earth Animal Nature's Protection line, which is a wonderful line and effective as when you use it, you know, when you use it and use it as a program. And we're going to talk about all of that. Okay. As we've been doing for the last few weeks, we're talking about the Earth Animal of the Week, who my Earth Animal or animals are. And I think it's fitting this week, kind of going with the theme of that we are all Earth Animals, right? I think my earth animals that I want to talk about and this week are the nurses across the country. And that's keeping in line with Nurse Appreciation Week, which was this week. I think it's, you know, anybody, even in the veterinary and veterinary technicians, everybody knows that the nurses in the hospital are just the core, and the technicians in a veterinary hospital are the core to the success of your treatment protocols, of the hospital, of the veterinary hospitals. And I think especially now where our nurses across the country, across the world, are all on the front lines of this, putting their own safety and potentially the safety of their families at risk, I think it's just important that we can't thank them enough. So nurses across the country are my Earth Animals of the Week. And they deserve all the thanks and the praise that we can give them, because they're out there. And again, like I was saying, even following that, the technicians in the veterinary community that are essential workers and also exposed at this time, I want to also recognize them, because, you know, certainly I know without my technicians, I would be nowhere right now. So I appreciate all of them. All right, let's get into the flea and tick protection. It's a, you know, obviously this time of year is it's very topical to talk about flea and tick control, because this is when we start to see a rise in fleas, the beginning of flea season, and certainly ticks, right? If we were having this conversation 10, 15 years ago, it's amazing how this is done a 180, because when we used to talk about flea and tick prevention and control, we always talked about fleas first. It used to be fleas, fleas, fleas. And this is, again, 15 years ago, 20 years ago, 10 years ago. And that has dramatically switched. And the reason why it has is fleas are a nuisance. We all know that. Certainly, fleas can cause itching of your pets and skin problems and you know, problems in the house, and can ultimately bite people. And we know that. But the fact of the matter is, and especially in this area of the country, ticks take, and preventing ticks take precedent. We used to talk about, again, 15 years ago, we used to talk about fleas primarily, and, you know, with ticks as kind of an adjunct. Hi, Stephanie. Thanks for joining us. If you just joined us, Stephanie, we had a glitch and we were off for a little bit. So you picked a good time to come in. Anyway, get rid of Stevie for now. So anyway, thanks for hanging with us, everybody who's hung around to talk about this. But just recapping again, right now, especially in this area of the country, up in the Northeast, you know, we are in the epicenter of you know, tick issues and tick problems and tick-borne disease. I don't think certainly not a week and many days I go with, there's not many days that go by that I don't get a Lyme positive dog or an anaplasma positive dog. And now we're seeing more and more Ehrlichias as well. So I see a lot of tick-borne disease at the practice, because there are just a lot of ticks out. And what we were talking about, again, as a lead-in before, we were talking about how really weather patterns have added to this. You know, we used to always, yeah, Greg, we're back. We're not replaying it. We're back in good standing. Hopefully this continues. Anyway, so The fact that we don't have these crisp seasons and we don't have these cold winters where you'll get die off of some parasites has had this ripple effect, and we don't get a die off like we used to. And like I was saying before, I mean, I didn't have to shovel any snow once this whole winter. We really had it pretty mild. So not only do they, you know, oftentimes not fully go away, but the beginning, you know, the end of the winter, the beginning of the spring, we get just, you know, there's just so many more parasites out there and so much more ticks. And we see flea season starting earlier. So I think, you know, one of the things that we want to talk about today is a program. And really, we have gone to trying to do year-round protection because I think it's important at this point. And so, again, what we're going to talk about is we'll talk about kind of some conventional flea and tick and what, you know, what's in them, and, you know, and then move into talking about the you know, Earth Animals Nature's Protection line that Dr. Bob Goldstein developed, which is a wonderful program. And so we're going to go, you know, we're going to talk about how it's effective, how to use it. And so we'll start out. Let's start out with, you know, again, like I said before, you know, I have been practicing for 24 years and it's changed so much over the years with the different flea products and tick products. And, you know, one of the things about the conventional flea and tick products are, there are now oral, okay, several different types. We have the traditional, which was one of the first things when I was practicing that was developed, was the spot-ons, okay? And we also have some other collars, you know. And one of the things about those as a group is really the way that they repel and kill fleas and ticks is they're neurotoxins. And what they do is they overstimulate the nervous system of the flea and the tick, and they can repel and kill them that way. So, you know, obviously they pose dangers with them, right? And, you know, while there's a lot of people that are on them, and, you know, but there are potential side effects to those. And, you know, one of the things that, you know, comes along with that is that you can also not stack these. So the beautiful thing about a natural product is you can stack products together to create this program we're talking about. And there are some people that on their own oftentimes will try to use two of the conventional. They use a collar and one of the oral conventional meds. And you can get into trouble doing that because you certainly never want to stack any sort of drug or chemical or mix because you don't know what's going to happen with them. And the safety margin is not high. So you really can't do that. And that is, again, the great thing about the natural products is that you can stack them and you can use them in conjunction. And when used like that, they can be very effective. Okay. The one of the other things with the orals that are on the market today is that you can't, you know, there's the warnings on those is you cannot use those if you have an animal that has a seizure disorder, epilepsy, things like that. They can precipitate seizures in those animals because of the nervous, you know, because of the how they work on the parasites. So, if you can use something with a much higher safety margin and it's effective, I always talk about then why wouldn't you? So that's why I want to get into the Nature's Protection line, because it really, you know, I've had several conversations on Bob, on his development of this, and it's really fascinating. And again, it's a program and we're going to talk about it. Now, the key to this Nature's Protection and any natural product that you're using is these do repel, not kill, okay? And so one of the things that I talk about with people is that it's very important that you're proactive. And that you know, that goes across the board. It's very important to be proactive with anything. You don't want to be reactive, you want to be proactive. It's important with a product, with a natural product, that you're proactive. You want to get them on this and have them on it. You don't want to come in when your animal all of a sudden has an infestation of fleas, or your animal's already had a lot of ticks, because they don't kill, they repel. So you don't, if you're in a situation where you have a flea problem, If you have an outdoor cat or dog and you notice that your dog is itching and they have fleas, well, you know, one of the things we always talk about when we talk to people about these flea infestations is really the problem. the fleas on your pet are 5%, are the top of the pyramid. The 95% then is a problem in your house, because those fleas lay eggs, they go in the house and they hatch. And it's pretty common knowledge throughout the veterinary community that if you do have a flea problem in the house, no matter what you do or what you use, it's 60 to 90 days before you can rid yourself of that problem. So the point is, we want to be proactive with this, and we want to do something year round, because again, we don't have these Kris seasons. We don't have this die off anymore. So it's important to kind of build, and you can, and we'll talk about how in high traffic times, in high times like this time of the year, you can add products in. And the beauty of the natural products, right? We can add products in to give more control when you need it, and more prevention when you need it, like now. Okay. There are a lot of ticks out right now in this region. I was hiking, you know, just like I said, this week, because it was so beautiful, and you know, I had ticks on me then. So it's something that we, so we'll talk about that. So the basis of this program, the bottom basis of this program, is the earth, is the nature's protection. It's a daily internal powder, okay? And this has several things in it that are developed to help your pet repel these parasites, okay? One of the basis, and there's two formulas. There's a yeast-based formula, and then there's an herbal formula. And I'll tell you the difference between the two of them. The yeast-based formula has brewer's yeast in it. Brewer's yeast has sulfur-containing amino acids, and brewer's yeast is fat soluble. Okay, so what it does is it gets into the sebaceous glands and into the skin, into the sebaceous glands of your pet. And while those are the glands that produce the oils for the pet's coat. And what it does is it puts the sulfur compound into and on the skin. Now, it's not perceivable by us, but it is definitely perceivable by the parasites. So it makes it an unattractive, you know, pet for them to get on and to bite. All right. It has other things. It has garlic, right? It has B vitamins in it. And what do B vitamins do? Well, one of the things about parasites, both fleas and ticks, and all parasites, internal parasites and everything, is parasites try to prey on the weak. So if you've ever had a multi-pet household and you've ever been on a, and you've ever had a flea issue, you know, one year we have a high traffic and you find fleas on one of your pets, and you have an older pet that's 13 and a younger pet that's 2, anytime that happens, you'll almost always notice that the older pet, who doesn't have the same kind of immune system as the younger pet, oftentimes will be more riddled with parasites than the younger, healthier, younger animals. So it really to have these B vitamins in it boosts the immune system, which is so important for fighting anything, and also helps that way. It also has things like zinc in it, which is great for the health of the skin. So it's not only a flea and tick product, it's also a health product for the animal. And that's something that we recommend that you would do year round. Okay. Because again, like I said, I think it's important. One, it's good for them. The other thing is that you're doing your base of this program. You're establishing your base and making the animal inhospitable to any of these ticks and fleas. Okay. So those two are the base of the program. All right. And then we have other problems, other items that you can then stack during very high traffic times. Okay, so like this time of year, we also have collars, okay, and we have spot-ons, and the way that you would use those is depending on your preference. Some people like collars on their animals, some people like the spot-ons. I prefer the spot-ons on my dogs because both of my dogs grab each other by the collar constantly, and they pull them off and they pull their other collars off, so I do prefer the spot-ons. But in large dogs and in really high times where there's a lot of ticks out and a lot of fleas out, what you can do is you can actually, in larger dogs, you could put a collar on them, and you can actually use the spot on lower down on the midline of their backs to cover their whole body. All right. And we go back to that. That's the beauty of these natural products. The beauty is we can stack them, use them together without untoward effects. All right. You know, in smaller dogs and obviously in cats, one product is fine because you have the coverage. They have a zone of coverage and you have the coverage. And then we have adjunct adjunct items in the line that you can use as needed. Okay. One of the things that I wanted to make sure I mentioned, because this is one of my favorite products on the planet. All right. I know you're getting a glare on that, but if you can see it, this is the herbal bug spray. Okay. So if you're going out and you're doing a walk around dusk and there's going to be a lot of mosquitoes, there's going to be, you know, you're going for a hike in the woods and you're worried, you can always spritz this over your pet. And I use this as my go-to bug spray. This is what I use for myself. It works really well. It smells really good. You don't have the chemicals on you do with traditionals, and it just is great. And then we have things like the daily herbal drops. Okay. And so one of the things with the herbal drops is you can use that if you're using the internal powders, but you would stack those with the yeast and not necessarily the herbals. You know, you would use those in conjunction with the yeast base, the original formula. All right. The other thing that I like in this time, and certainly this time of year, is the herbal shampoo. All right. So when you're, you know, this time of year, you're out with your dogs, you get rain, there's mud, you have to bathe the animal. This is a great go-to, because one, it will not dry out the skin. It actually moisturizes the skin, but it also does help prevent. You have the same, you know, essential oils in this. It smells wonderful. So it's a great shampoo to use as needed during the seasons and whenever you want. So I think that this whole line, I think the take home is that one, very safe, and the fact that you can use them all together is wonderful, because you can use them when you feel like you need to add something else in, okay? And the last thing that we have out now is the herbal topical powder. Now, this is the one in the line that will actually kill the parasites. So if you do get something in the house, you can use this topically on your carpets and you know, in your house. You can use this on pets if you do. It actually has some limestone in it, and it works like diatomaceous earth, which is, if anybody's familiar with that, it actually does two things. It draws water out of the parasites, so it will, you know, will kill them that way, and it actually will scratch the surface of their, anybody that knows about parasites know they have these really hard, and the reason why they're tough to kill oftentimes is they have these really hard exoskeletons, right? Well, this will scarify or cut up the exoskeletons and also cause them to die. So that's the one product that will kill the parasites in the thing, and the others repel, okay? So, you know, when I always talk to people about this, and I talk to whether you use traditional or conventional versus a natural product, I always say, and really, if you take home anything from this talk, my go-to is, if you can do something naturally and it's effective, why wouldn't you? And that's the bottom line. If you can do something that's safe and healthy for your pet, and you know, one of the things that Dr. Bob and Susan like to talk about is that this program treats your pet, helps your pet repel these from the inside out, and then you use the other products from top to bottom, okay? And you're not using your pet as a vector with a chemical to treat, you know, to treat and kill and repel parasites. And that's really the fundamental of that program. Let's see if we have a question wise. Hey, Jan, I see your question about the goose. I'll call you when I get out of here. Just have to give me a little bit. Once we're done, I'll grab your number at the office. I'll give you a ring. Okay. All right. Let's see if what else we have. Hey, Vanessa. So you have it. You asked how are you? You asked what the difference between the brewer's yeast and the non-brewer's yeast formula. Well, the difference is one, that we don't, the brewer's yeast is taken out of the herbal formula, but what they've done is, what Dr. Bob has done is, they've put herbs to mimic what the sulfur producing that the brewer's yeast does. Okay. So it does a similar effect just with herbal products rather than the brewer's yeast. I hope that answers it. Yeah. Teresa. Yeah, I agree that the bug spray is fantastic. It works. We've used it down the beach. It works really kind of for all the flying insects and any of the parasites as well. So I really do think it's great. And again, it smells great. All right, let's see, Morgan. Hi, Dr. Kris. So Morgan asked about indoor cats, and that's a really good point. You know, One of the big questions, and I think some of the misconceptions that people have are indoor cats, well, they're indoors and they don't need any flea and tick protection. And, you know, when people have products applied to their yard or they, you know, they go, I think there's oftentimes a misconception that a lot of these fleas and ticks are hanging out in the grass. And the fact is, most of these fleas and ticks are in the bushes around the base of the house and by the front door. So I always take in just like people when they go to the doctor, every pet is individual, and you have to treat them. No two pets have the same, unless they live in the same house, have the same, you know, the same conditions, the same home life. So you have to take each one as an individual. Okay. So when I talk to people about does my pet need flea and tick, my indoor cat only, one, there's a lot that goes into that answer, right? So one is, are there other animals in the house that go outside that could potentially carry something in with them? All right. The other thing is, if they live in a house that's on the ground floor, when that door opens and you have all the shrubbery and everything and all the landscaping around there, that's where all the raccoons, the possums, everything that are running around at night go, and obviously they run along those bushes. So there are oftentimes the highest density of those parasites in through there. So they can come in through the front door and crawl in. So, and I've seen indoor cats with no other animals in the house that live in a house that come up with fleas. So I do recommend, in a situation like that, I do recommend that you use products. I do recommend that you use the products for your indoor cats. Now, here's the exception. Certainly, if you live in an apartment that's on the 10th floor of an apartment building and the animals never go outside, you don't have other pets that go outside, you may not need them at that point. But you just, you know, it's certainly something to talk to your veterinarian about and see, you know, and again, it depends. They're each individual, so you have to treat them that way. Oh, that's good, Vanessa. Say hi to Gidget for me, Vanessa. Michael, how long do the internal powders take before the effects are there? What do you recommend in the meantime when I go hiking with my dog? He seems to be a tick magnet. I think right now all dogs are tick magnets, right? I think it's just with the amount that are out there. So, and so are we. So it's important if you guys go hiking that you check yourselves as well. What I would recommend is while you're, you know, you would also use the adjunct of the externals, the collars, the topical herbal, the topical spot-ons, okay? And any of the other products that we talked about while those powders are taking effect. Now, again, you know, some people ask me too, if my animal is already on the conventional or the, you know, the traditional flea and tick, how can I integrate it? And my answer to them is I would start the internal powders while you're waiting. You know, a lot of them are monthly or things. Start them, let that build up. And when you would be due for your next, when you're due for your next treatment, then you can add in the other topicals. So it's important to kind of build, right? Hi, Angel, good question. You know, how do you manage the brewer's yeast protection? Obviously, like you said, daily. It's a daily in the food. You want to sprinkle it. Is it effective if your dog doesn't eat daily? Well, it's not as effective, okay? I know some animals, but in that case, we have the option of using or backing up with the topicals, okay? Again, the beauty of this natural is that we can stack it. The beauty of nature's protection is you can use multiple because they can be given together, which we can't do with traditionals, okay? So that's a great question, Angel. Anybody else have any other questions? All right, so let's talk about our spotlight of the week, all right? So I know that we get some glare on this, so I wanna make sure you guys can see this. So our spotlight of the week is Bag of Bones Barkery in Hamilton, New Jersey, okay? And we love them for several reasons. And one of which is they, since 2005, they've been offering animals a better breed of treats. They bake their own treats there. They actually use very high ingredients to produce a variety of wonderful treats for your pet. So we absolutely, Greg and Melissa, they have a strong passion for making these treats for your animals. So please visit their website. Please go, and I'm sure they're doing curbside if you can, or delivery. So please take a look at them. Obviously right now it's very important for us to be going to our local shops. These are, like we said, we're doing this once a week. It's hugely important during this time. All right. And thank you guys. Thank you Thank you, Bag of Bones, for being such a great earth animal retailer. And thanks, Greg, for bouncing in today. Okay, last thing. We have to do the code word for the day. So the first person that calls in to Bag of Bones that calls in with this passcode will get a $50 gift certificate. All right? Password is honk. So password's honk. Call them now. And they ship nationwide. Thanks, Greg. That's fantastic. And thank you for being such a good earth animal retailer. Let me see if we have anything else. Oh, hey, Catherine. Yeah, good question. Teresa, I think, answered it. But yes, they are waterproof, so your dog can swim with these. And that's obviously important because we have a lot of swimmers that need this protection as well. So yes, they are. Good question as well. Thanks for the help, Teresa. I didn't see it. All right, next week with Ask Our Vet, we're going to do the general question and answer, okay? So we're going to spend the entire hour with you on general questions for any questions you might have. So think of what you want and please join us then, okay? All right. And I also want to say, everyone, be well and happy Mother's Day to all the mothers out there. Happy Mother's Day to my wife. Happy Mother's Day to my mom down in South Carolina. Hopefully you're watching. And I just want to say, everyone, please be safe. Thanks for hanging out with us with the glitch. And Pamela, you had a question on collars. Yeah, we're talking about the Nature's Protection collar today. Okay. And that's the one. And I can talk to you offline about that as well. All right. All right. All right, everybody. Thanks for hanging with the glitch. That's the first one we've had on this series. And I know we're off for a bit, but so I really appreciate everybody hanging around. All right. Everyone have a great weekend. Thanks. Bye.